All right, trickies and trickers, time for the third episode review of the day, Destiny. Constable Odo, followed closely by Commander Sisko, enters one of the station's many living quarters. He explains that he assigned the senior Cardassian scientist, Ulani Belord, to these quarters with her colleague, Galora Rajal, being accommodated in the adjacent room. Sisko immediately notices the unusual warmth of the room, believing Odo had adjusted the environmental controls to suit the scientist's needs, and he is right. Odo further explains that he also had Chief O'Brien program the replicators to produce Cardassian food and assigned two deputies to watch them carefully during their trip, though the commander tells him to keep his distance. He wants scientists to feel like guests, not prisoners. Odo, in typical fashion, replies with the caution of a security officer. As he explains, there are still some elements opposed to the recent Bajoran Cardassian treaty on both sides, and so they have to be prepared for trouble. Though Sisko agrees with the statement, he also wants the Bajorans to get used to seeing Cardassians walking down the promenade, buying from their shops, eating from their restaurants, getting to know them as something other than brutal overseers. Just then, they are interrupted by Lieutenant Dax, who reports he's just received the scientist's design on the proposed transceiver for the communications relay, but she isn't entirely convinced that it's going to work. Sisko assures her the Cardassians are certainly confident of success, to which she smiles and expresses her hopes they will be too. Before the three of them can discuss it further, Quark enters two bottles of Kenar and expresses interest in which of the scientists will be staying there, Galora or Ulani. Odo seems surprised that Quark is aware of their names, since he only found out about an hour ago. Odo, please, Quark smiles. Managing to evade the question, he reveals he has brought a bottle of Kenar for each of them with a personal invitation to Quark's. Dax also seems surprised, but for a different reason. She asks Ferengi where he has managed to obtain the real Kenar, which explains he has had three cases of it sitting in a storeroom since the occupation, and there hasn't been much call for it the past few years. But that's about to change, he says, as there are sure to be more Cardassians visiting the station as a result of the new peace treaty. Dex smiles, quoting what she believes is the theory to further wealth acquisition: peace is good for business. However, Quark corrects her: 34th is war is good for business. But you can see how she might have gotten them confused. Back to the topic at hand. Quark believes it won't be long before there's a permanent Cardassian presence on the station. Scientists, diplomats, spies, all of whom would be welcome at Quark's. In fact, he even says he might even rent the shop next to his bar and open up Cardassian gaming concessions. Sensing trouble, Odo quickly reminds him there will be no live vol fights on the promenade, and Sisko backs him up. Content to make some sacrifices, Quark was on division his new enterprise, where his bar is known for having the best Cardassian food and drink in the sector, though this is sadly interrupted by Dax, who informs him his Kenar has gone bad. Odo instructs Quark to leave, half seriously saying he may well have to arrest him for attempting to poison their guests. Quark makes hasty departure, taking along the Kenar. A little while later, Sisko is in his office working on a pad when Mijikir notifies him that a Vedic Yarka has arrived and requests to meet with him urgently. Sisko nods to Kira, just as the Yarka is standing outside. The Vedic runs in with some urgency and reveals he has an important warning from the prophets. If he allows the Cardassians on the station, he will bring destruction upon them all. Vedic Yarka explains that it's been foretold in Trekker's third prophecy. When the river wakes, stirred once more to Janir's side, three vipers will return to their nest in the sky. The river has awakened, he says to Sisko. As Kira reveals, he is referring to the Quial Dam, which has just been put back into operation to divert water to the city, and the Cardassian scientists, the three vipers, are now on the way to the station. Their nest in the sky. The commander seems skeptical, holding, but nevertheless asks how the rival will bring destruction on them all. Yarka continues to recite the prophecy. The vipers try to peer through the temple gates. A sword of stars will appear in the heavens. The temple will burn, and skates shall be cast open. The compressed scientist attempts at communication through the wormhole, the celestial temple, and survivors try to peer through the temple gates. If they do so, he says, the wormhole will be destroyed. Kira points out to him that only two scientists will be arriving at the station, not three, and asks if it's possible whether there could be more mistakes in his interpretation. But Yarka is adamant. There will be three vipers, you will see, he asserts. Sisko still isn't convinced. He also reads the benefits of the communication relay for Bajor, how they will communicate with ships on either side of the wormhole and facilitate exploration, how they can monitor the Dominion in case of attack. But the Vedic dismisses the benefits as irrelevant, sure that they are on the verge of a great disaster. Sisko asks if the Vedic assembly is aware of the prophecy. Yarko says both the assembly and Kai Wen know of it but choose to ignore the signs. The commander reiterates his stance. In common with the Bajoran government, he has no intention of calling off the project. Yarko expresses his dismay at the decision but informs Sisko he and his followers will remain on the station, praying he changes his mind. As the Vedic leaves, Sisko instructs Kira to have Odo find out everything he can on him and his followers. He doesn't want them causing any trouble while the Cardassians are on the station. In the airlock, the large circular doors are wheeled back to reveal the two Cardassian women. Sisko welcomes them both to Deep Space Nine on behalf of the Federation and Starfleet Command, while Kira stands in silence. After a brief introduction, she too welcomes them on behalf of the Bajoran Provisional Government, hoping this project will mark a new era of peace between Bajor and Cardassia, though she is clearly uncomfortable with the situation. With the formalities out of the way, Sisko asks them how their trip was. Ulani, seeming more relaxed, jokes it was very exhausting, though preparing for the trip was equally as tiring. She explains how goals she has never heard of before have contacted her about the mission, reminding her of the importance, to which Sisko relates, commenting on three calls he has received from Starfleet Command just that morning in a more serious tone. Ulani expresses her gratitude to Kira for allowing them to conduct the work on the station, much to Kira's surprise. "I'll work with anyone who's interested in peace," she replies. After resting in their quarters, the scientists meet up with Sisko, Kira, O'Brien, and Dax for a briefing in the wardroom. On the wall, there's a diagram of the wormhole with Deep Space Nine at one end and the communication relay at the other. Sisko explains the plan is to place the relay 2 kilometers away from the far side of the wormhole, while Galore begins to describe the transceiver they will be installing. Partway through, she stops herself, realizing she called the station with the old Cardassian name, Terek Nor. After quickly correcting herself, Dax asks Ulani what sort of carry wave they'll be using to counter the interference inside the wormhole. She switches to a trilinear approach to testing several different soliton pulses. Certain one will prove successful. O'Brien recognizes the plan as one they attempted a year ago without much success. The Galora, confident in her ability, believes the problem was in the phase variance of the transceiver coils. Depending on his skills as an engineer, the chief says the variance was less than 0.01%, but yet again, Galore argues, saying it was too high and the new design has less than half that variance. The chief is convinced and wants to go over the plans himself. Ulani then interrupts, realizing an argument is developing. She reminds Sisko that a few adjustments will need to be made to the station's signaling array so that it can accommodate the transmissions. Who assures her Chief O'Brien's people can handle it while they take the OSS to find to the Gamma Quadrant and deploy the relay. With that, the meeting concludes and Galore and Ulani head back to their quarters. Turning to Kira, Sisko jokes, "Now those are about the two friendliest vipers I've ever met," which elicits a few strange looks from Dax and O'Brien. Sisko tells him he will explain himself later. Just when it seems everything is in order, Ulani returns to the wardroom and informs Sisko that another colleague, Sajar, will be arriving later in the day. Sisko says that the quarters will be arranged by the time she arrives. Ulani thanks him and heads out, leaving Sisko to brief senior staff on another issue. However, just as the commander takes a seat, he pauses, noticing a expressionless Kira staring at the bulkhead. He asks her what is wrong. "There are going to be three of them," she quietly replies. "Three vipers, just like in the prophecy." In the security office, Odo reveals that Vedic Yarka is no longer a Vedic at all. He was stripped of his title just 2 months ago because he didn't adhere to Bajoran beliefs, at least that is the official reason. Odo happens to know from his sources that Yarka led a series of protests against the Vedic assembly when he endorsed the peace treaty with Cardassia. So this theorizes that Yarka is using the prophecy as a way to scuttle the treaty. Odo agrees, saying he was also covering his view of it as well, just like Sisko's agenda colors the way he sees it. The commander defends himself, saying he wants the project to go ahead in the interest of peace. If he thought for a moment that the wormhole was in danger, he would put a stop to it. That wasn't what Odo was referring to. It's absurd how Sisko prefers to distance himself from the title emissary, and he has never been comfortable with it. Sisko sighs in agreement. "I can't deny that," he says, but realizing Odo may be hinting at something more. He asks him if he thinks he is dismissing the prophecy too easily, because it doesn't want to be the emissary. Odo says he isn't suggesting anything. It has simply been his understanding that all humanoids have an agenda of some sort, an agenda that informs their decisions without them knowing it. Meanwhile, Kira and Dr. Bashir are taking a walk down the promenade, discussing how Morton was taken ill by a bad glass of Cork's Canard. Kira quips he should get a refund, though, as Bashir explains, the odd thing was it was on the house. Halfway down the promenade, they are interrupted by Yarka. After Bashir excuses himself, Yarka implores Kira to talk to Sisko about the prophecy and convince him not to go ahead with the project, but Kira denies him, explaining that he is her superior officer and she must deal with him on that basis first, thereby keeping her work and beliefs separate. Bjarke continues to insist she not turn back on her faith and presents his case to Sisko. What's your faith, Nerys? He says. What do you have left? In Quarks, Dax is discussing the Cardassian poetry with Ulani and Galora, while Bordo Bran looks on. She feels that when her previous host, Tobin, actually got to meet Locha of Prim during his exile on Vulcan, much to scientists' disbelief. At that moment, Quark arrives and presents their colleague, Dajar. After the necessary introductions, Ulani expresses surprise at her early arrival. Dajar explains she was able to arrange special transportation. There was an uncomfortable aura between the two, which Jackson and O'Brien seemed to pick up on. Quark certainly does as he attempts to alleviate it by presenting some traditional Cardassian food, Dajar and Yamak sauce and Rogova eggs. The Dajar seems to enjoy it. Galora and Ulani admit that they don't really care for Cardassian cuisine. To everyone's amusement, that's everyone but Dajar. Later in Ops, O'Brien is assisting Galore with the work needed to interface the transceiver with the station. As she pulls away one of the panels in the engineering pit, Galore gasps in amazement at the sight of the modified conduits. O'Brien explains they have to make some modifications in order to meet Starfleet codes and regulations, which require a secondary backup system. Galore points out that the chances of both the primary system and its backup failing at the same time are extremely likely, and although O'Brien agrees, he says he wouldn't like to be caught without secondary backup in a crunch. She decides to find another way to go about the modifications and begin making some calculations on her pad. When O'Brien tries to provide some assistance, she shuts him down, requiring some time to think. Fine, an annoyed O'Brien says, sitting himself quietly down on the consoles. Unaware of her obvious abruptness, she asks him to get her a cup of real leaf tea. Why not? O'Brien sarcastically replies, climbing out of the pit. On the Defiant, Kira pours the communication room has been loaded into the cargo bay and the chief should be ready in 4 hours. Sisko acknowledges the information and instructs Dax to set a course for the wormhole. In the Gamma Quadrant, Dax runs a complete scan nearby space, checking for any Dominion presence. The scan initially turns up negative, but just as Sisko gives the order to deploy the relay, sensors detect a rogue comet just inside detection range. Dax reports it contains an enormous amount of silithium, giving an unusually bright tail. As Kira observes the comet on the view screen, she remembers four words from the prophecy, the Sword of Stars. Eleni says Kira's choice of words is a very colorful way to describe a comet. She replies by saying it's simply a figure of speech. Alina turns her attention back to her work, knowing the comet will pass close to the wormhole but should interfere with their plans. Sisko orders Dax to begin a final systems check on the relay station to deploy within the hour, before summoning the Major to another room for a more private conversation. They arrive in one of the crew cabins where the commander instructs her to keep the prophecy to herself, especially on the Bridge of the Defiant. It is some of the Cardassians finding out about it. Kira agrees, sitting herself down on the bunks, Sisko sighs, firmly asserting that she believes the prophecy is coming true. Kira tells him that it is a decision to make here and now, confessing she has always believed him to be the emissary of the prophets. It's hard to work for someone who's a religious icon, she smiles. Sisko doesn't share her convictions and reminds her that he considers himself a Starfleet officer, not an emissary, and if he is to call off the mission, it would have to be a solid reason, a Starfleet reason. Kira proposes that the prophets, or wormhole aliens, pass their knowledge of the future onto Dracor, who then wrote it down in the form of his prophecy. And now, 3,000 years later, they are seeing these events unfold. To me, she argues, that reason sounds concrete, solid. I'd even call it Starfleet. Just then, Dax interrupts over the comm, advising the ready to deploy the relay. Kira looks at him with him with hope in her eyes, hoping he will change his mind and stop the project. But where she sees a prophecy, Sisko sees a comet. I'm on my way, he responds. Back at the station, Glorious working Odian Reilly with O'Brien. Odian Reilly while O'Brien stands watching in the background. She complains of all the modifications in her places, which have made her job even more difficult. O'Brien tries to convince her that if she would explain to him what she intends to do, he could help. She responds by admitting it is because he is a man that she is so reluctant to accept his help. Men just don't seem to have a head for this sort of thing, she says. The chief is persistent, telling her that nobody knows the systems better than him, including her, and she would be wise to accept his help. Glorious concedes, handing him the laser torch she was using. On the other side of the wormhole, the relay is in position alongside the Defiant. Dax reports she's ready to initiate the relay's transmission array. She reports the test signal from the relay is coming through clearly while Lonnie instructs Dax to initiate a carry wave in the Delta Band frequency. She explains that if the station receives it, they will send acknowledging signal on the same frequency. Sisko smiles in anticipation. Lakira remains noticeably concerned. After a few moments of silence, it becomes apparent the transmission was unsuccessful. Pressing a few buttons on her pad, only then instructs Dax to initiate the signal along the Theta Band frequency. Almost immediately, it becomes clear that something is wrong. The wormhole springs open, emitting a massive neutrino surge, rocketing the Defiant back and forth. Jaskier reports the gravity well has increased by a factor of 3. Sisko quickly orders Dax to terminate the carrier wave, closing the wormhole. Sisko seeks an explanation, but no one can provide one. The signal should not have affected the wormhole at all. Before anyone can theorize what happened, Dax notices the comet has been pulled off course and is heading straight for the wormhole. If it enters, the silithium will cause a cascade reaction, collapsing the wormhole permanently. Everyone is assembled in the wardroom when Dax explains the carrier wave they transmitted created a subspace inversion in the wormhole, which caused the gravity well to form. Alone reveals the possibility of a subspace inversion was present in one of their simulations, but presented less than 2% risk, so they chose to leave it out of the information they sent. Sisko tells them they prefer to examine all possibilities before conducting field tests, to which she agrees. However, the Cardassian Science Ministry falls under the purview of the military, and they are always instructed not to make a project look unnecessarily dangerous. The commander advises them all to keep that in mind when they resume work on the relay. Dajar, who has spread up until now, declares a new team that will most likely be assembled prior to another attempt. Turning their attention to the comet, Dax explains that tractor beam most likely caused it to fragment in more pieces, creating a bigger mess. Glorious comments the same thing would happen traced over the phaser beam through O'Brien's, though O'Brien's not so sure. He thinks he can modify the Defiant's phaser array to point out to compass the entire comet. Sisko directs him to start right away and concludes their meeting. On the Defiant, O'Brien and Galore are working away in one of the Jeffries tubes. The chief explains what he is attempting to do, but it seems Galore is far more interested in O'Brien himself than the work. As he reaches to an emitter coupling, she grabs his hand holding up to hers. "You have very steady hands," she says. "I can feel so O'Brien doesn't quite know what to make of it," she replying. "Well, they get the job done." Before removing his hand from hers, attempting to get back to his work, O'Brien leads the signalmeter and continues his adjustments, before she suddenly surprises him yet again. "I'm quite fertile," she says, prompting O'Brien to bang his head on the paneling in shock. "I could provide you with many healthy children, if that's your concern. Frankly, I think you're getting a little happy yourself." O'Brien is astonished at what she's saying, and says later has a child and a wife. It seems she took his irritability for desire to pursue a physical relationship. The chief suddenly understands and says he's not remotely interested in her. Just as the words escape his mouth, he realizes he has said the wrong thing and tries to soften the blow. But Glor understands what his feelings are toward her and, turning around, crawls back out of the Jeffries tube, leaving him to finish the adjustments on his own. Dax arrives at Sisko's office, where O'Brien says the phasers will be ready in half an hour. Sisko, with knowledge of it, seems to be more interested in what's on his computer display. It says he's been looking through the Bajoran prophecies, and nearly all of them can be considered accurate if they are interpreted in a certain way. Dax observes he is afraid that Trakor's third prophecy will come true unless he sends the Cardassians home. The gates of heaven will burn and be cast open. She asks him what he would do if he had never heard of the prophecy. So the obvious plan is he would continue work on the relay. To extract, Dax offers him two choices. He'd make his own decisions or allow the prophecies to make them for him. The commander leaves for it and turns off his monitor, or stands in front of Dax. As soon as the find is ready, he says, "Have the Cardassians meet us on board." The time soon arrives. The find access to wormhole and Cisco orders Dex to place it within 10 kilometers of the comet. As soon as O'Brien reports the phasers are locked on target, the commander gives the order to fire, but something goes wrong. The terror weapon's relay blows, sending sparks flying across the bridge. Dexter's modified phasers never came online, and they never actually fired the comet with standard phasers, fracturing instead of vaporizing it as intended. There's now 3 fragments and only 26 minutes away from the wormhole. Without weapons, there was no way to stop them. O'Brien explains the main emitter coupling has been depolarized, something which must have happened when he tried to modify the power flow. He is noticeably annoyed with himself as it's something a first-year engineering student wouldn't miss. Throughout the whole thing, Gloria and Milani each send icy glare to Jar as if they know something. Jar starts back to find them to say anything, but Gloria does. She reveals that Jar is a member of the Obsidian Order and was assigned to them for security. Cisco then puts two and two together. The Obsidian Order has long been opposed to the peace treaty with Bajor and would happily see the project fail if it damaged Bajoran relations. Jar obviously insists it's all speculation, but is confined to quarters nonetheless. With Jar out of the way, they begin to develop a plan on how to stop the comet. Milani suggests expanding subspace field around the fragments, which might just be enough to contain the dilithium during transit through the wormhole. O'Brien suggests using the warp drive to generate the field, as it finds too large to maneuver in between the fragments. Cisco decides he'll have to use a shuttle pod, and he is going to be the pilot. After ordering Kira to assume command and take the ship back to the Alpha Quadrant, he starts to head off, but is soon stopped by the Major, who expresses her desire to join them, to help her emissary. Not any much convincing, Cisco hands the bridge over to Dax instead. In the shuttle pod, Cisco lays in a course for the tail end of the fragments, allowing them to easier position themselves between the large chunks of rock and ice. Meanwhile, the Defiant exits the wormhole on the side of the Alpha Quadrant. Dax orders the helm to maintain position and ready transporters, just in case. Assuming the position, Kira activates the subspace field, encompassing all the fragments in one bubble. From inside the cockpit, the wormhole can be seen as it flashes open a bright light, dragging the pod and the fragments through. At first, the field seems to be holding, but soon begins to lose integrity as small amounts of silithium slip through. Cisco instructs the root power from the engines to the field. The one on Earth will have to carry them the rest of the way. On the Defiant, O'Brien detects the standard neutrino surge as the wormhole opens to reveal the shuttle pod and tag with the fragments. Cisco sighs a sigh of relief as he deactivates subspace field, holding them in place. Just as Dax checks they're all right, O'Brien announces the test signal from relays being broadcast through the wormhole. I checked the fragments left just enough silithium trail to allow subspace signals to pass through. Kira realizes that all this time they had misinterpreted the prophecy. The three Vipers didn't mean the Cardassians, but the Recumbent fragments. Peering through the duplicates was a reference to the attempt to establish the communication relay in the first place. Brain duplicates refer to the silithium's reaction with the wormhole itself to create a subspace filament through the wormhole, in which the end did provide a communication pathway, so the duplicates would never close again, and the sort of stars used by the emissary refer to the comet's silithium tail itself. Back on the station, O'Brien is walking Galore back to the airlock. He thanks her for what she did back on the Defiant and hopes she doesn't face too much trouble when she gets back to Cardassia. She believes her superiors will protect her from any serious repercussions and that Jar will be the one in trouble when the Obsidian Order finds out she failed in her duty. As they reach the airlock, she turns to the Chief, telling him he has a lucky wife. Giving him a small kiss on the cheek, she finally says, "Goodbye, Mr. O'Brien," before turning and heading out towards the airlock, leaving the Chief to reflect on recent events. Shortly thereafter, Yarko is walking with Cisco down the promenade. He takes the opportunity to apologize to the commander for doubting him and admits his own distress for the Cardassians, blinding him to the prophet's words. As they continue walking, he reveals something more. There's an answer to Kira's fourth prophecy coming true in the near future and includes the emissary. Thinking about it for a moment, the commander replies, "Tell me about it." Interesting. So let's take a look at some continuity surrounding this episode. Kira Clopton, who plays Jake Sisko, does not appear in this episode. Reference rules of acquisition number 34. War is good for business, and 35, peace is good for business. This episode makes reference to the Bajoran-Cardassian Treaty establishing life support. Yambok Sauce was first seen in the first season episode Progress and was created by former series producer Peter Allen Fields. Bear said of his conclusion this episode, two of the things Field gave us were Yamak sauce and self-sealing stem bolts. They're silly names, and I like silly names, so every now and then we just like to bring them back. The Defiant's Type 18 shuttle pod first appeared in the two-part episode The Surge Part 1 and Surge Part 2. This episode marks its last appearance on the series. Jakor's fourth prophecy, which begins, the emissary will face a fiery trial and will be forced to choose. May refer to the events in the series finale, What You Leave Behind. However, there are a number of other events, both namely before and during the Dominion War, to which the prophecy could also apply. Sisko's behavior in this episode, and his attitude to his role as emissary, contrasts sharply with how he would ultimately feel about being a religious icon. Throughout the 4th, 5th, 6th, and 7th seasons, Sisko would become more and more comfortable with his position in the eyes of Bajoran people, a process which is played out over the course of the 4th season episode, Accession, where he's forced to fight for his right to be emissary, and the 5th season episode, Rapture, where he sees visions of the future from the prophets, as well as in his interactions with the prophets in episodes like Sacrifice of Angels, Images in the Sand, Shadows and Symbols, and the series finale, What You Leave Behind. Interesting. So overall, I think this episode is pretty damn good, and yeah, I do like the fact that Sisko is kind of struggling with his role as the emissary and how he is kind of reluctant about it, but he does step up to the table and ultimately comes to terms with it later on in the series, so yeah. So overall, I give Destiny 5 warp cores out of 5. When I'm tuned in a bit as we take a look at the final episode of the day, Profit Motive. So, until then, live long and prosper, everybody.